Hello, this is Dr. J back with some more Let's Play Command and Conquer Red Alert. We have completed all of the Allied missions. Now it's time to turn to an alternate non-canonical take on the war and do the Soviet campaign. Now, when I play games, if it's at all possible, I like to sort of immerse myself in the role, do a little bit of role playing. I find that that's fairly easy to do, excuse me, with the Allied campaign. The Allied forces, as depicted in the game, are fighting a defensive war when they are unilaterally invaded by the Soviet Union. It's fairly easy to imagine myself as an Allied commander defending my homeland against the Soviet invasion. I find that I have a bit more difficulty immersing myself in the role with the Soviet campaign. For one thing, the Soviet Union was a real-life evil empire from recent history that committed countless horrific atrocities and murdered tens of millions of people. And for a second thing, your boss is Stalin, who is one of history's greatest monsters, and your fellow commanders and generals are a bunch of scumbags jockeying for position who mostly just want to kill each other, including you, the player. So there's not exactly a big sense of camaraderie on the Soviet side. All that said, when I'm playing the Soviet campaign, I like to imagine that although I'm a Soviet officer and I am fighting against the Allied forces, I'm actually an agent working on behalf of a certain someone for an ancient and secret organization seeking to supplant the Soviet Union from within. I'm sure everyone watching knows exactly who and what I'm talking about. So with that as my premise, with myself as an agent for this ancient and secret society, I'm going to go ahead and embark upon the Soviet campaign. Let's get this party started.
Gradenko, how long did it take the gas to work?
Is it safe to speak?
Of course. Go on.
The kill time depends upon the weight of the subject. The children were terminated in less than 15 seconds, and the adults took longer, 18 to 42 seconds.
No survivors?
None, Comrade Stalin.
The total dead?
Approximately 840.
My intelligence said there were 877 people in the village. How do you account for this discrepancy?
Inaccurate intelligence?
Enough. Begin full production of the gas.
Already underway, Comrade Stalin.
Meet our newest officer. According to this profile, you should prove useful.
I would like to see that profile.
Give the lieutenant something important to do. That is all, Gradenko.
Forgive me, Comrade Stalin, but there is something else. Outside Torun, we have met with guerrilla resistance. They have blocked the roads into town here and here.
They are enemies of the people. Destroy the town and kill everyone in it. Come, my dear. I have an assignment which requires your special skills.
Let's see how you handle this. Go at once to Torun. Destroy everything and everyone. No prisoners, no survivors. That is all.
Reinforcements have arrived. Well, we see that a certain someone clearly slept her way to the top. And to Westwood's credit, they don't shy away from depicting the evil of the Soviet Union. Our very first assignment is obliterating some of our own citizens. And we spent the briefing discussing the production of sarin nerve gas. What lovely people we are. Well, let's get this show on the road. In this first mission, we're not fighting proper Allied forces, but rather random resistance forces, so it's not exactly going to be difficult. They tried blowing the bridge, but we have an air force, so that was a futile gesture. Well, let's go about killing everybody we see. Let's get those yaks back in the air. Yaks are not a particularly good unit. However, for the purposes of eliminating random resistance forces, they're more than enough to get the job done. That's the last of our infantry drop, but we get more reinforcements immediately. This first mission is incredibly easy, just like the first mission in basically every real-time strategy game. After all, the whole purpose is to get you used to the controls and everything. Alright, well, destroy the town and kill everyone in it. Let's start blowing up the buildings. Bomb those oil drums that the resistance has foolishly put next to their pillboxes. They blew this bridge. We'll see if they blow this one as well. But again, it will be futile since we have an air force. Another fuel drum to destroy. Okay, and that was easy. All right, mission one complete. That was about as short and easy as the first Allied mission. Our opponents were basically a bunch of peasants with a handful of guns and a couple of jeeps. And we had plenty of reinforcements to get the job done. Onward to mission two.
Congratulations on earning this assignment, Commander. I am Captain Georgi Kukov, Chief of Field Operations for this region. Beyond this river lies Germany. Tomorrow our attack begins. For today, you have guard duty. See to it that nothing happens to the base or to the command center. The Allies have been moving closer and closer to our position. Watch out for sneak attacks. If conflict erupts, you have permission to take the fight to them. See you in Berlin.
All right, this time, instead of fighting a few random, pathetic civilian rebels, we are actually up against proper Allied forces. Let's go ahead and start scouting out the map. We have now been introduced to all the major characters on the Soviet side. First, we saw, in addition to obviously Stalin, we also saw Nadia and Gradenko. And, in that briefing just there, we met Kukov. So they are our fellow commanders. A bunch of conniving scumbags, as I said before. I guess Gradenko actually never tries to stab the player in the back, or anybody else for that matter. Kukov and Nadia, on the other hand, are a different story. Though, as we will see much later in the campaign, Nadia does kind of come to the player's defense. Alright. Let's see. I am not going to bother building a second ore refinery for this mission. One will be plenty. Alright. Allied Ranger got the scouts on that side. I may build two barracks just so we can train units faster. Oh wow. That guy managed to kill us all at once. That's grenadiers for you. I do not much care for grenadiers. They're basically walking bombs who will kill all your own forces when they explode. I'm just going to put the dogs at the back of my base where they won't get killed. I have a soft spot for dogs, so I'm not going to send them into battle. They can just chill out at the back of our base. They're also not a particularly useful unit in general. They can sniff out spies. They're the only unit that will autonomously attack spies. Otherwise, spies have to be targeted manually. We saw plenty of that in the Allied campaign. Alright, let's see if we can cross this bridge. I expect the Allies will destroy it when we attempt to cross. Might as well build a couple of yaks for the comedy value, if nothing else. Okay, yep, they blew the bridge. The Allies seem fond of that tactic. A massive rifle infantry should be plenty to overcome the enemy base. And let's see if we have any good strafing opportunities for our yaks. Go get that Ranger. Yaks are not very good. Two of them can't even destroy a Ranger with one strafing run. Interestingly, when they blew the bridge by detonating those fuel drums, they also severely damaged their own turrets. In this mission where we can only make infantry and yaks, turrets are not going to be a particularly effective defense. The Allies should have built pillboxes, but they chose not to. Alright, I think that now that we've got a platoon of infantry, that'll be enough. Looks like the Allies are sending a pair of guys. Flame Tower should take care of that. Yep, and they just charged right into range. Let's do another strafing run with our yaks on this turret. It's already severely damaged, so maybe they'll be able to accomplish something. Now that we're playing as the Soviets, it's actually not even out of character for us to destroy churches. It was always a little weird doing that as the Allies, from a role-playing perspective. We just did it because there's always crates in one of the churches, so there was a gameplay benefit. Otherwise, it didn't make much sense. Alright, let's get this Ranger and then take out the ore truck. Hopefully it won't squish everybody. It does start out half damaged as a courtesy to the player, since we can only train infantry. And this many riflemen can actually bring an ore truck down pretty quickly. Reinforcements have arrived, you say? Ah, we got some paratroops to augment our attack. Alright, men, spread out and level everything. Don't be lazy, destroy. There, that way I won't have to listen to silos needed. And we clearly don't need to make any more units. We have obviously won this fight. More reinforcements, completely redundant at this point.
Mission accomplished.
Well done to us. I will admit, evil symbol though it may be, the hammer and sickle is pretty cool looking. Overlay them on top of each other and it makes a pretty cool looking shape. Alright. Well, we obviously have time to do another mission. These early missions are quick and easy. We might even be able to get through four of them in one video. We'll see.
Imperialists are at our mercy. We have 14 tank divisions on this border.
And the Allies with only 3 divisions hold you off.
At the rate of our noble comrades' advance, we will occupy all of Europe within 60 days.
Perhaps, but 11 months over schedule. It is vital to our propaganda efforts that we take Berlin before Comrade Stalin's birthday.
Comrade Gradenko, did you not report all our nerve gas sites secure?
I inspected them myself.
And how did the Allied dogs eliminate our Sovrensk facility?
Impossible. My security was...
inefficient, as we feared. That plant was our primary site. Will there be enough nerve gas left to proceed with our plan? What about Einstein? Is his propulsion system research still on schedule?
Well?
I must report. A few hours ago, Einstein was kidnapped.
I know.
We are recovering him as we speak.
Good. Good! I do not wish to kill so committed an officer as you, Gradenko.
I don't know where Einstein is, yet. But I do know who betrayed our cause. We have tracked him down in Lan, where he undoubtedly waits to rendezvous with resistance forces. He must die a traitor's death. Get to Kree again and use your dogs to sniff out the coward before he can take refuge in a safe house.
And there we saw that, although Gradenko is the only one of the Soviet generals who doesn't have murderous designs on his fellow commanders, he's also flamingly incompetent, and we're always having to clean up after his messes. We start off with just a pack of dogs, who obviously are not going to be able to get past a pillbox, so we're going to have to go off to the side here. All right, and by killing those guys, we get access to some rifle infantry, who should actually be able to get past the pillbox, since there's yet more explosive barrels. Man, the Allies need to learn not to place explosive barrels next to every single one of their structures. All right, get the barrel. Well done to us. Now we continue pursuing the spy. We also saw... in that briefing, Kane whispering something into Stalin's ear. More evidence besides the sort of allusion to GDI on the Allied side that Westwood originally intended this game to be a straight-up prequel to Command & Conquer before later apparently changing their minds and Red Alert 2 becoming its own completely separate thing. Get down here, dogs. Alright, the Allied spy is continuing to keep a step ahead of us. Alright, looks like he's hiding in the church. We'll flush him out of there. Clearly the civilians are in cahoots. In fact, there's even Allied soldiers hiding within their buildings. How dare you kill my dogs?
Yes, sir.
I take it back, the Allies are completely evil.
Reinforcements have arrived.
Then the spy ducks into an LST and escapes across the whatever kind of body of water this is, lake. All right, we got reinforcements. Where? Ah, there they are. Must have been a paradrop. We do have a time limit on this mission, 10 minutes remaining. It's a pretty generous time limit. We're unlikely to run out of time. Much like Allies Mission 3, this is a little bit of a puzzly type of mission, pre-deployed. You have to make good use of the units you're given. And we are kind of... we're not outnumbered, but these odds are a little too even for my liking. I think what we'll do is we'll send the infantry in first to cover for the dogs. Then we'll send the dogs in to eat everybody. Okay, no, that kind of worked. We have one dog left. We can force fire on the spy if we completely run out of dogs. Alright, let's get the fuel drum again. Okay. One of these days, the Allies are going to learn not to put fuel drums everywhere. Spy is still running for it, but we're closing the distance. One more gauntlet of Allied forces that we have to get through. They got the dog! Whew! One guy survives with one hit point. That came down to the wire. We did get a few more reinforcements. Only three guys. Hopefully there's no more Allied forces left. Oh, there's a couple Raka soldiers. Now, ordinarily, Raka soldiers are terrible against infantry, but since we have only one guy, they're actually fairly likely to kill him. So he should maybe retreat to his friends who are bringing up the rear. I'm apparently not playing this mission very well because I don't think it has to be this close. So this is the first of the Soviet missions that is actually potentially a little bit tricky. And a little bit puzzly. I've said many times I really like missions like this. All right, let's make our way through this maze of barbed wire that the Allies appear to have set up. And this force will easily be able to overcome a pair of rocket soldiers. Then we'll flush the spy out of the church and put an end to him. These Allied vermin deserve to die for killing all our dogs. Alright, we can actually target him. We don't even have to force fire. Get wrecked.
Mission accomplished.
Alright, that's three missions done in a little over 20 minutes. Looks like we're definitely going to have time for Soviet Mission 4 this video. We're really going through them quick, but the early missions are like this, fast and easy. All right, onward to the next.
Good work dealing with that spy. You please, Stalin. Make sure you never disappoint him. Now, I have a special task for you. We are amassing for our attack on Berlin. The Allies are aware of this, so we are going to, how do they say, throw them a bone? I want you to create a diversion. Occupy their troops until we can drop soldiers behind their lines. Once the troops are in, use the soldiers to cut off Allied communications. With no early warning, we can take Berlin by surprise.
Alright, time for our first true base-building mission. Mission 2 is kind of like a base-building mission, but it's so easy that it hardly counts. And also, we don't have access to much in the way of technology or forces. Much like the Allied campaign, we get access to armored units starting in just Mission 4. Quite a bit faster than in the original Command & Conquer. So, despite the fact that the Soviet forces are heavier than the Allied, playing as the Soviets is going to be fairly similar on missions like this. Build up giant tank armies and then roll over the enemies en masse. It's pretty much a strategy regardless of which faction you're playing as. We shouldn't need as many tanks to do the job because our tanks are heavier, but they're also more expensive, so the overall amount of time that it takes to build up an overwhelming force should be approximately the same. Now, fighting the Allies, I think, is going to feel a bit different from fighting the Soviets. Because the Allies are supposed to be kind of a guerrilla faction, Westwood did rather a good job of depicting the Allied fighting tactics to reflect that. So, for example, the Allied bases are going to be covered in gap generators, which make it hard for us to see what's going on in their bases. And they're going to pull a variety of dirty tricks throughout the missions, and the deeper we get into the Soviet campaign, the more sneaky Allied tricks we're going to have to deal with. So I quite like that. I like that they really did sort of flavor the way the Soviet and Allied factions fight differently in the campaign missions. Now, in some ways, Allied bases should be easier to crack because they don't have Tesla coils. They have turrets and pillboxes, but we'll attack with such overwhelming numbers of tanks that their turrets aren't going to be much of a factor. Oh, there's the gap generator doing its thing. We briefly saw a turret that fired at us, but then it was immediately covered by Shroud again. So information warfare is going to be one of the hallmarks of fighting the Allies, as depicted in that manner. Okay, let's start getting the war factory up and running. The Allies will repeatedly get reinforcements from off the board in this mission until we destroy their radar dome, which is what they're using to call in the reinforcements. You would think if the guys who are sending them reinforcements from off the map lost contact with them completely, that they would find that alarming and send a large force to investigate, but apparently not. Apparently once they lose contact, they assume that means everything is A-okay. So we're actually going to have to apply ourselves a bit in this mission. It's not a complete face roll like the previous missions were. You know what? I'm even going to build a third ore truck. That's how seriously I'm going to take this mission. Probably unnecessary, but... let's go ahead and get some scouts going too. I'll use grenadiers as scouts because they're quicker than regular infantry. Other than that, I'll probably never build them. They're walking bombs who will just cause massive collateral damage, just like in Command & Conquer. Alright, now we can build V2 rockets as well. I don't think we'll get anything interesting if we build a service depot. Maybe an anti-personnel mine layer? I'm not going to bother with that. We will build an airfield to see if we get access to the spy plane. Or to paradrops. There are also parabombs, but they're basically worthless. I doubt we'll ever destroy anything with parabombs. Okay, just yaks. That's worthless then. I'll sell it. Get some more scouts. Alright, little infantry attack. We can deal with that. Going for the harvester. Squish everyone. Squish them. Well done. I might as well build a service depot anyway. I might want to repair some of my vehicles or something. Well, this guy's ambitious, whatever his plan is. Aha, alright. V2 rocket launcher will handle these guys. Oh man, missed the first one even though I tried to lead him. The V2's rocket is pretty slow moving. But their range is incredible. They're a much better artillery unit than the actual Allied artillery. Really? Oh, a medium tank. How quaint. One medium against a horde of heavies is not going to fare particularly well. As with the vast majority of the missions that have variants, the two variants of this mission are incredibly similar to each other, so we won't bother doing both of them. The other variant is basically the same as this, just with a slightly different map layout. Our power is a little borderline. We might want one additional power plant to give us some leeway. We're pulling in the money so quick, let's build a second war factory. Oh wow. That's quite a few Allied vehicles buzzing around. Quick queue moving! There we go. As soon as they stop, they die pretty much instantly. While they're moving, we can't hit them to save our lives. That could have been a more threatening attack if they had attacked all at once, but it's so staggered we can just take them out piecemeal. Alright, I think we have more than enough forces to go take care of business. It is so silly looking how infantry eat dozens of tank shells in the face. It makes sense from a balance perspective and wanting to create a rock-paper-scissors kind of mechanic, but it just looks ridiculous. I suppose additional forces we create we can leave back at the base for defense just in case we get attacked while we're out. Go kill them if you please. He's thinking about it. There you go. He really had to line up that shot. There's the gap generator. It basically looks like a giant tuning fork. It is much more durable than you would expect. It takes tons of hits to kill a gap generator. I will say this much, although typically I prefer playing as good guys rather than bad guys, as a general rule. The Soviet missions are fun. They are every bit as much fun to play as the Allied missions. Well designed. Alright, let's roll over them. Take out the refinery to put a stop to their economy. Another gap generator down there. Do they have a war factory up here? Nope, but they have their construction yard. Even better. Oh, and more fuel drums. We're encountering a fair amount of resistance, but not enough. Okay, so they've got their radar dome up there on the ridge. I suppose we can bring in our other force now. Let's do a pincer attack and bring it around the other way. Oh, looks like... No, I was going to say it looks like they just got some reinforcements from off the map, but I don't think they did. I'm guessing there's probably going to be a crate hidden under this. Yep, there always is. More money for us. Where did that guy come from? Well, let's... There he is, hiding in the corner. Alright, main group will continue its rampage of destruction. While secondary group begins moving to the north. Just build up an overwhelming economy, and this is a pretty easy mission. But if you're not prepared for it, if you just kind of dicker around, the scale of the Allied resistance can be a little surprising. They actually can be threatening if you don't take them seriously. Alright, let's take out that radar dome and put a stop to the reinforcements after we've already destroyed virtually everything else on the mission. Objective 1 complete. Screw your silos. Alright, what remains on the map? Oh, there's a single dude there. Sucks to be that guy. He's got the whole Soviet army bearing down on him. I hear something else. Oh, there's there's a whole gate into the enemy's base here. Complete with turrets and pillboxes. Maybe we should do something about that. Q moving is still valuable as the Soviets. Their tanks aren't as fast, but they'll still take greatly reduced damage if you keep them moving as much as possible. Okay. What remains now? A single power plant. Nope, two power plants tucked away here. Kind of an irritating place to put them. Really, the only point of doing this is to be annoying and make the mission take a little longer. Shut up, Ava. Now what the heck? Oh. The war factory was there the entire time. It actually was there. Just hiding under this one piece of shroud. Okay, this should do it. Those look more like medium tanks than heavy tanks, but otherwise a cool little ending cutscene there. And the usual score screen bugging out. Alright, that's going to do it for this video. Man, four missions in one video. Look at us go. Next, we're going to take a brief one-minute, one-mission side jaunt into the first of the Soviet expansion missions before returning to the main campaign for another four. Hopefully you'll join me for that, and I'll see you then.